Now man is born into this world from the womb of his mother, and his days are few and full of troubles. And according to both pagan and Christian mystic writings, this man who is few of days has only one hope, and that is that by some wonderful and sacred reality beyond his comprehension, he may, while still alive, die and be raised again. Therefore, the sacred institutions were the houses of the second birth, the houses from which a man is born again, from the womb of the mysteries, from the heart, soul, and body of the great mother, who is forever bearing her sons, and yet to the end is forever a virgin. This is the song that Julian sings to us, the song of the house of wisdom. For wisdom has builded its house, and here it dwells, waiting for its sons. This wisdom is Pallas Athena, the patron goddess of Athens, the crown city, the queen of the house of learning. This is Cybele, Merita, Astarte, Istok, all the great mothers, the mothers of rites, the mothers who give birth to the immortal sons who never die. The ritual perhaps began in Egypt, for it is certain that there, Isis mourning for her lord represents the great institution of the state religion. Isis was not primarily regarded in the mysteries as a person, but was the bride of heaven. In the Apocalypse of John, which derives part of its authority from the rites of Phrygia, which were practiced in the area around Patmos, where it is said John was for long exiled. In these rites, we have a new understanding from the book of Revelation of the mystery of the bridegroom and the marriage of the city of Jerusalem to the Lamb. And Jerusalem was adorned as a bride. This marriage of Jerusalem to the Lamb of Heaven is the story that lies at the root of the great cycle of Isis and Osiris. Actually, Osiris represents the eternal wisdom principle. Isis, his consort, is his house, or his institution in the world. Isis, therefore, represents the great theocratic order, just as truly as the same is perpetuated in Christianity under the symbolism of the Virgin Mary. Isis, the Virgin Mary, Cybele, and the great Diana are therefore the magnificent organizations or institutions built up out of the world for the worship and adoration of the gods. This is, again, a very interesting psychical or psychological mystery. For the temple is always the symbol of the human soul. The temple is suspended like man's soul between spirit and body. As spirit descends from the invisible and divine world to possess and ensoul, so the psychic nature itself, the human soul, ascending out of the complication and mystery of matter, rises from its own mortality and sphinx-like guards the gates of wisdom. This soul then, redeemed out of body, purified from body, is the holy city, the New Jerusalem of Saint Augustine. And it is the human soul that is then the bride of the Lamb. And the great theocratic and sacerdotal systems of the pagan world were regarded as these sacred cities that became united eternally to the god who was their patron deity. Now in the Isis and Osiris cycle, Osiris, the great one, or the great deity, is foully murdered by his own brother. And Isis, the mistress, becomes widowed and barren. And she puts upon her head sackcloth and ashes. And she goes forth weeping for her Lord, seeking always and forever for the mysterious power, the great rites, the secret lost word that must be found, or the great arcana cannot be restored. And Isis, seeking for her Lord, is, as we might say it, the concept of knowledge, the concept of education, the great concept of universities and colleges as we know them today. To the ancients, they would have been the widowed Isis weeping for her Lord, searching everywhere for him, but not able to find him. This quest is the quest for knowledge, the eternal search for the eternal vanities. Now in the Isis Osiris cycle, while Isis is wandering in her widow's weeds, searching for that which is lost forever, there appears to her the specter of her own deceased husband. Osiris comes in the form of a Holy Spirit. Osiris comes in the form of the Holy Ghost. And he comes to announce to her that she shall bear a son, and that this son shall be for the salvation of the nations. And therefore it is said that Isis conceived of the Holy Spirit of her own deceased husband, and she brought forth Horus the younger, the child that was born after his father was dead. In fact, was conceived after his father was dead. Therefore, he was born of a Holy Spirit. He was a widow's son. He was one dedicated to a strange and wonderful destiny. And Typhon, the assassin of Osiris and the wicked brother, discovering that this child had been born, sent forth emissaries to all parts of Egypt to discover the child and slay him. And in this course there is also reference to the slaughter of innocent children who were mistaken for him. But Isis, guided by Mercury, hid her child where none could find it, hiding it in the reeds by the side of the river Nile. And the child was saved and grew up to be a fine and splendid man. And when this had occurred, and when the time came for the child's lock of hair to be cut off, and Horus came into his adolescent period, which is the second period of life in ancient Egypt. And then Isis received from the ghost of her husband Osiris the promise that he would be forever present with this child and would guide him and lead him. And when Horus the younger reached his 30th year, which was the Egyptian age of maturity, on that occasion a strange and wonderful thing happened. For at that time Osiris, the god himself, entered into the body of his own son and was born in him, and took over and became the ruler of that body. So that in this mystery, as the ancient Egyptian papyrus tells us, the father and the son were identical. And then it was that Osiris proudly cries out, "Who hath seen the Father hath seen the Son, for the Son is in the Father is in the Son, and they are one being to eternity." This was pronounced 1,000 years B.C. Now this mystery goes into many ramifications, but Osiris always represents the great mystery itself, the eternal truth, the living power. And Isis, widow of her Lord, is the priesthood, the sacerdotal institutions, the schools of the mistress. And the son that is born of the invisible spirit and the widowed wife is Horus the Hatshepsut, the son of the hawk, the redeemer, the light bearer, the intercessor, the one who stands in the hall of judgment with every soul that dies and pleads with the Father for the forgiveness of its sins. And Horus is the one who, when the soul of the dead person seems to be lost, takes upon itself the sin of the dead, and in that way gains its redemption. These old rites and mysteries go way back. Julian knew them. Julian had been through the sacred rites. He knew what their meanings were and what they portended in a world seeking truth. And so Isis is the great house, the house of God on earth. Isis was the many-roomed chambers of initiation, the dark hidden womb from which flow the ever-born ones, the sons of the hawk, the armies of the redeemed, who shall sometime in the last great war, which is the Armageddon, will be locked in eternal struggle with the powers of darkness, and in the end, in those times beyond eternity and time, right shall be victorious, and the kingdom shall be returned to Osiris the Father, who will come in glory and receive unto himself his beloved Son.